Coomaraswamy once wrote, "An artist is not a special type of man, but every man is a special type of artist." How incredibly foreign is this saying to us modern people? But in fact, there was a time in which hunters, doctors, farmers, lawyers, surgeons, and scientists were all considered to be artists. Art, in contrast to how we understand it today, once had a universal meaning. Hello everyone, welcome to this series of videos on Ananda Coomaraswamy. In the previous video, we talked about Coomaraswamy's life and went over some of his important works. In this video, however, we're going to deal with Coomaraswamy's theory and philosophy of art. As we know it, Coomaraswamy was the most important art critic of the 20th century. He has written remarkable articles and volumes on this subject, an art historian, an expert in Oriental and medieval philosophy of art, and also a philologist. He knew 27 languages, and that includes Greek, Latin, Sanskrit, Pali, the chief European languages, Arabic, Farsi, Persian, Chinese, and many, many other languages. He was incredibly erudite. He had read widely in many different fields, including mythology, anthropology. He was a master of traditional metaphysics. Coomaraswamy's influences were first and foremost Rumi, Meister Eckhart, Philo, Plato, Plotinus, the pre-Socratics, Aristotle, St. Thomas, St. Augustine, Marsilio Ficino, Shankara, and many, many other notable figures, including René Guénon, who had a tremendous impact on Coomaraswamy around 1929 or 30. Now before we continue, I would like to briefly mention the books that I've used for the production of this video. The first book is Christian and Oriental Philosophy of Art, written by Coomaraswamy. It's a collection of articles on this subject, and I think it's Coomaraswamy's most widely read book. Now the second book is Traditional Art and Symbolism. This book was published by Princeton University. It's a wonderful collection of Coomaraswamy's articles on the subject. But the thing is that this book is very rare and very expensive, so it's quite difficult to find. And lastly, we've used this book, Transformation of Nature and Art. This book is very important. It contains material from both Oriental and medieval philosophy of art. Now let's find out what Coomaraswamy has to say about art, its philosophy, and its metaphysics. European art, according to Coomaraswamy, is of two very different kinds: Christian and scholastic, post-Renaissance and personal. All throughout these eras, except the modern times, and especially after the Renaissance, art began to lose its meaning and its dependence on the principles. Art, which was once a universal language, became a movement. Soon we had Surrealism, Expressionism, Impressionism, Modernism, Pop Art, Romanticism, Cubism, etc. People were divided into two groups. Either you were an artist or you were not. Art became a luxury from which only the elite could benefit. Artists became more inclined to exhibit themselves rather than their artworks, and people became more interested in knowing about the artist's personal life rather than their artwork. Whereas in the past, the artists were mostly anonymous, and it's very difficult for us, the more that we go back in time, to satisfy our curiosity with regards to the artist's personal life. Self-expression and originality became the key characteristics of modern art. Plato, by whom Coomaraswamy was tremendously influenced, said in his Book of Laws that "I cannot give the name of art to anything irrational." Now, the majority of the artworks that exist in the modern world are very appealing to the senses. They stimulate our emotions. Some make us sad, melancholic, happy, some make us bewildered, and some of them evoke the passions. According to Coomaraswamy, in the modern world we have invented an aesthetics, and think of art as a sensation and a feeling. Webster Dictionary defines the word aesthetic as follows: responsive to or appreciative of what is pleasurable to the senses and especially sight. Coomaraswamy, who was an incredible linguist, would sometimes go to the root of whatever the word that he's treating and bring about its true meaning. For example, with regards to aesthetics, he said that this word comes from the Greek aesthesis, that is, a sort of perception by feeling. He tells us, "The Greek original of the word aesthetic means perception by the senses, especially by feeling. Aesthetic experience is a faculty that we share with animals and vegetables and is irrational." Coomaraswamy says that the majority of the artworks are sentimental and they appeal to the senses, but they do not satisfy the needs of the mind, endorses the Platonic notion of art that a good work of art serves the body and the soul. Now, how should we feel when we're looking at a work of art? How does art supposed to make us feel? Because there are times that we're staring at a painting in a museum or a gallery and we're quite confused. We don't know what to make out of this particular artwork. We try to give meaning to it. Now, a good work of art doesn't need you to do that. Immediately, we understand what the artist is trying to communicate. Now, a good work of art does this through a symbolic language, and traditional art is of a symbolic kind. Now, Coomaraswamy was an exponent of the traditional art. He did not propound any new theories of art, and he did not say anything original. It is quite interesting that Coomaraswamy's uniqueness is, in a sense, his unoriginality. He was totally against the idea of setting out new theories. Now, this does not mean that he was against innovation and progress, but what he emphasized most importantly was to go back to the principles, to what has already been said, and try to comprehend and understand them. In one of his articles, Coomaraswamy says, "Throughout this essay, I shall be using the very words of the Middle Ages. I have nothing new to propound, for such as I am, the truth about art, as well as about many other things, is not a truth that remains to be discovered, but a truth that it remains for every man to understand." What he basically did was that he revived the traditional philosophy of art and metaphysics in a language both lucid and elegant and highly, highly mathematical. He appreciated greatly the saying of Emil Mayl, who said, "Christian art is a calculus." And he says that if modern art cannot be explained in terms of the same philosophy, it may be because it has no ends beyond itself, because it is too fine to be applied and too significant to mean anything. Now, for Coomaraswamy, art wasn't something that had to do with the senses alone, but art, according to him, pertains to knowledge and the mind. He was very fond of quoting St. Thomas of Aquinas. With parallel to St. Thomas, Coomaraswamy would often quote Plato a lot. Now, what is the goal of art according to traditional philosophy? Plato gives a definite answer to this. He says that the goal of art must be intellectual beatitude, and not merely the satisfaction of the senses. According to Aristotle and Plato, the goal of art must be a catharsis, that is, a defeat of the senses of pleasure and pain. Catharsis is a sacrificial purgation and purification, consisting in a separation, as far as it is possible, of the soul from the body. The Platonic catharsis implies an ecstasy, or standing aside of the energetic, spiritual, and imperturbable self from the passive, aesthetic, and natural self. Coomaraswamy talks about a concept called samvega, or aesthetic shock. The Pali word samvega is often used to denote the shock or wonder that may be felt when the perception of a work of art becomes a serious experience. Now, we have all to some degree experienced this when perhaps reading a book of poetry or looking at a particular painting. Coomaraswamy also tells us that we can experience this feeling when we realize the transient and the passing nature of life, how natural beauty slowly withers and how everything is in a constant state of flux. Samvega is a state of shock, agitation, fear, awe, wonder, or delight induced by some physically or mentally poignant experience. I have myself been completely dissolved and broken up by the same music, and had the same experience when reading aloud Plato's Phaedo. That cannot have been an aesthetic emotion, such as could have been felt in the presence of some insignificant work of art, but represents the shock of conviction that only an intellectual art can deliver, the body blow that is delivered by any perfect and therefore convincing statement of truth. It is the business of art to grasp the primordial truth, to make the inaudible audible, to enunciate the primordial word, to reproduce the primordial images, or it is not art. In other words, a real art is one of symbolic and significant representation, a representation of things that cannot be seen except by the intellect.